Alright. We've got audio. Let me turn on the mic. Beautiful indeed. White balance. That's better.
White balance. That's the most racist thing. What's the story with this traffic sign?
It's a traffic sign.
How did it get here? Did someone wreck into it out in front?
Wait, things just show up here.
Yeah.
Right?
That is true. I just want to know what the story is.
It's a curious story. It's curious indeed. All right. Ready to do this?
Yes. I have the costume. Do you want me to put on just the hat?
It's 1:59, so whatever you want to do.
Well, I want to wear, you know what? I don't have to put on the extra cape, but I could sure put on the robe. No. If you want me to.
Boy, oh boy. Already getting text messages from the show.
Did we say something on the timeline, the Facebook timeline, about the early edition of the show?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And my keyboard doesn't want to connect now. Connect. There it is. Let's bring up our chat room. And let's open this. Open with VLC.
What's that?
Playback speed at a little faster than 2. Alright, I see a video. I'd love to see a chat room. Where's our little chat room? Loading. Hey everybody. Hey, there's the chat. There's us. There's that. Hey, everybody. Just about ready to check it out. Check us out.
Okay, sounds good.
Turn this mic on and I'm good to go.
Hello. As usual, I'm going to start the show myself. Because a wizard always arrives when he means to. I'm Justin. This is Torn Tuesday. Welcome to a very special early episode. It is Christmas Eve, and we have a lot to celebrate and be thankful for, because Peter Jackson took a one movie book and turned it into a full trilogy. And today we're going to talk about everything that's good about the trilogy and everything great about The Desolation of Smaug, as Peter Jackson would pronounce it.
Feed me Frodo's line. Give me Frodo's line. Frodo's line, his first line to Gandalf, feed it to me. You're late.
There's no need to make fun.
No, go ahead. They'll go, no. Say, feed me Frodo's line so I can do Gandalf's line. Do Frodo's line.
I don't know what his line is.
You're late.
I know we're late. It's 2:04.
No, but just play a little. Come on. Feed me the line. Give me Frodo's line and I'll do Gandalf's line. No,
I don't know Frodo's line.
You're late.
But I know we're late. It's 2:04.
Who's on first? No, go ahead. Give me the line.
Who's... you're late.
A wizard is never late. Nor is he early. He arrives precisely when he means to. Welcome, everyone, to Torn Tuesday.
See what I have to deal with.
It's time to celebrate a holiday with friends and family and loved ones and even the people you can barely tolerate, we managed to bring it all together. Here.
If you say so.
At the wonderful studio. Hello, everyone. Here at the wonderful attic studio space at Meltdown Comics. Here in Hollywood, California. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the show.
Am I going to do this whole show with Gandalf? I guess.
You're going to do this whole show with me doing Skype and FaceTime and everything with all of our friends.
So,
hello everybody, welcome to the show.
We're as usual, you can text us at 530-64-FRODO.
Hello.
530-64-FRODO, and you can Skype us at The One Ring Net. One word, no spaces, no dots. The One Ring Net. The name should come up as Barlamin Butterbur or something like that. So we'll open up the Skype and chat
lines.
We will.
We will indeed. It would be wonderful to have everyone join us on the show.
Later. But this is the second in a series.
Yes.
Last time, we talked about everything wrong with Desolation, mostly from a bookworm's perspective that hated the movie. And today, we're going to talk about everything right because it's Christmas. It's the holidays.
Hate is a much too strong a word.
Oh, no. You were ready to burn your tickets.
I was not ready to burn my
ticket. The fire was in your eyes.
I was not ready to see that damn dragon dead, but they didn't do that.
I know. I'm glad he's alive because now I can get dragon mugs in
and toys. Yes, you can.
I can't wait for Comic-Con where they might have a full-size dragon like we saw in Germany. Might get your picture taken with. Like, Comic-Con just became a lot cooler.
That might be really kind of cool. Yeah, I imagine they're going to pull out some magical, surprising things. But
so we're live on theonering.net/live.
Yes, thank you for joining us live.
Chat room full of people. Love the hats. Hey, how's it going? I stole the One Ring. Bofors wife, Jawalan dude, LZ, Eva.
Hello, everybody on the show.
Everybody's here.
Oh, and by the way, a special birthday wish to I Stole the One Ring. Hello, Heather, and happy birthday to you.
So, we're just going to go through this episode. We're going to talk about everything that's right about Desolation, and that's probably going to be mostly me talking.
I don't know about that.
And Cliff and Gandalf here can chime in when he means to, because I love the movie. I've seen it 5 times already. One does not watch Smaug just once.
Yes, indeed. That is true.
It is everything I wanted and more. You know, and I'm coming at it from a perspective. I came into the Desolation purely from a movie fan point of view. I haven't read the Hobbit book. I've read Lord of the Rings and Silmarillion, but I haven't read the Hobbit. I vaguely remember seeing a cartoon with really terrible animation when I was a kid. And that's all I remember. It was
terrible
gross.
Animation.
It was ugly.
It was so, like, yeah, it was not terrible.
For to a 6-year-old, it wasn't Disney quality.
No, it's not supposed to be Disney quality.
Well, this to a 6-year-old, you're
totally
not...
Totally different approach to animation.
A 6-year-old is not versed in the...
Japanese anime?
In like, all he knows is Mickey Mouse and Bugs Bunny come from the same place. Like, it's that's all. Cartoons are cartoons. This was and so the original Hobbit cartoon... wasn't one of my favorites.
It wasn't one of my favorites, and it was the one that I grew up on, and I thought it was, and I didn't know it at the time, but it was my first introduction to Japanese animation, and it was some of the earliest artwork that I would see coming from Studio Ghibli later on, because many of those artists went after The Hobbit, and they did The Last Unicorn, and they did that Return of the King animated version, then they went and formed Topcraft, which was... animation studio
and we know
cultivated
from a previous,
into Miyazaki's studio, Ghibli.
A previous episode, we had the creator of Ren and Stimpy, John Chris Felucci. He was here, and he actually worked for a couple of those animation studios in the late 70s, about the same time that these movies were made. So you can thank the creator of Ren and Stimpy for making the Hobbit cartoon probably as memorable as anything. So
you mean the Lord of the Rings Bakshi cartoon?
Yeah,
different from the Hobbit cartoon.
Which they all looked at. They were all just squiggly lined animation.
Squiggly lined. You had C-3PO, Anthony Daniels as the voice of Legolas. How cool is that? Ralph Bakshi made something really cool.
I didn't see Star Wars until the special edition.
Oh, for heaven's sake! Really?
Really? My geek cred in the last 5 minutes now has just been demolished. So I just
want to talk
about this movie. And first off, I want to say that the intro logos are amazing. They look good in 3D. They look good in 2D. I like the coming out of the lion's eye. I like the
Did you notice the spider web?
I noticed the spider web.
I
appreciate that Warner Brothers is allowed, just like from Harry Potter. Every Harry Potter movie had a different looking Warner Brothers logo. This Hobbit movie had a different Warner Brothers logo. And then they brought us right into Bree, something familiar. Something I was sorely missing from the first Hobbit movie was any hearkening back to the Lord of the Rings movies, which won a bunch of Oscars, made $3 billion, and made me fall in love with Tolkien.
Yeah.
And so I wanted more of that, and here we are at Bree. I'm like, oh, good, finally, like... We're in a rainstorm. It's dark. We're in a pub. Like, this is exactly what I'm hoping for. And so that whole scene, the opening scene, and Peter Jackson's cameo, get that out of the way first. Get the fans happy. Okay, as long as the fans are happy within the first 10 seconds, the rest of the movie, like, they'll come along for the ride, which it turns out they needed to
come along
for a ride.
I had no problem at all with the really interesting dialogue-driven prologue. Did you notice that the prologue in all the other movies has been really like action heavy and lots of events and very specific events, but this prologue, Desolation of Smaug, was interesting in that it was mostly dialogue, character, relationship building than instead of a big action set piece, which is very interesting.
And I think I liked it. And I think
the
that the cameos in the first pub scene, you had John Howe was back there, Alan Lee was back there.
Was he?
Peter Jackson's daughter was the barmaid, Peter Jackson himself walking out of his pub. So there were a ton of cameos in the first 10 seconds. It's like, let's just get this out of the way. And it really feels
really
like that first intro really feels like it was shot in during the pickups. But I think the whole thing we're getting text messages. She's so cute. Merry Christmas Eve to you. Thank you.
Merry Christmas Eve to everybody else too.
Yeah.
Now this is interesting.
So
at one point in Fellowship of the Ring, we only have the suggestion that there's somebody dangerous in the corner watching Frodo, and Sam warns him. In this opening prologue of Desolation of Smaug, the two characters are explicitly dangerous.
Peter Jackson hits you over the head, like with everything else in The Hobbit. He hits you over the head, like no subtleties here. Like, see that mean guy in the corner? He's mean.
Did you know it was the same cat? The exact same cat.
Really?
No, it wasn't the same cat. I'm sure it might have been a different cat, but it's still a brief little shot of a cute black cat sitting right there in The Prancing Pony, just like in Fellowship of the Ring.
Eva's asking, how many times have you guys seen the movie? I've seen it 5 times. I've seen it in 2D, 3D, 3D HFR, 3D HFR IMAX and another just regular 3D. I'm still waiting to see Atmos.
Yes, indeed. And I have seen it twice. I've seen it in regular 24 frames per second 3D, and I've seen it in high frame rate HFR IMAX 3D. Those are my two experiences with the film.
You know what I really liked about the intro is that Gandalf is just setting it up from the get-go. Like, I know about your dad. I got this map, and I got, or not this map, I got this thing, and it tells me that there's a bounty out for you, and so you need to get on your horse or pony and get doing what you're doing. So I really appreciated the setup. Like that this setup was needed. Now when we actually go back into the movie, it felt like it was a little dropped in right into the story, and I loved it. I loved seeing, like, all right, they're back on the chase, they're back on the hunt. I love the titles of the Desolation of Smaug with the opening
over the mountains,
epic mountains. That was it just felt like, and there's snowy mountains too, so it was straight up Two Towers. I'm gonna make a lot of comparisons to Two Towers today because it's the second movie. That was the second movie, and he intentionally does a lot of hearkening back to Two Towers.
There's
a lot of not subtlety either.
Also?
There's no subtleties in The Hobbit. But there's like, hey, we've got something else on our trail, and it's a bear, and Gandalf has, like, he repeats this like 8 times during this movie. He goes, no, we should run, no, we should go, no, we should sit, stay, no, we should, he might be dangerous, danger, that's Gandalf's thing. And Bomber is the hero of this whole movie. The fact that he runs fast when they're running away from the bear, and there's just like everything about Beorn was cool. And I know there was a lot of heat when we first leaked those photos of Beorn.
The fan reaction to Beorn was surprising, and Justin, you seem to directly think that influenced the theatrical cut.
I think that the negative reaction that people had on our site, and it blew up the blogosphere, was everywhere.
The mullet,
well, the 80s hair thing.
It looked like a mullet.
And people were just like, oh my gosh, is this like a Bon Jovi movie? People were hating. People that wanted this big hairy beast, and I think that Beorn's part was severely diminished in the final edit of this movie because of that fan reaction. But the one, so there was a lot, you know.
I
wanted to see more Beorn. I wanted to see him chopping wood, and I wanted to see him have dialogue with Gandalf, which we know for sure they shot. We know for sure that he had an axe in his hand.
Yeah.
They wouldn't have had that sneak preview on the calendar if he didn't have something to do with an axe. So.
Well, then that must have been the next day. The next day, because the first thing we see in the Beorn scene is the nighttime scenes. After they've been chased inside the door has been bolted shut, and Gandalf says, "That is our host." You know?
Right. First he's like,
says, "That's our host."
I know. First he's like, "We gotta run! Run!" And then he's like, "This is our host. Host!" Like,
well, okay. The thing is, why we get that little bit of dialogue so that the audience goes, "Ooh, that's our host." You know, that's the way the dialogue is constructed.
I got to say, I was first confused because I didn't know Beorn was a bear, or that silhouette that we first see was a bear, because
He looks like a warg.
No, he looks like a warg. That doesn't look like a bear. And we talked about this on Everything Wrong with the Hobbit. He didn't really look like a bear. But I thought everything else, Mikael Persbrandt did an excellent, excellent job.
I'll agree.
Delivering the dialogue, get these guys on our way. He's like, he's just there to show up, introduce himself, and then get these dwarves back on their journey safely. And he does that, and he pours a mean milk.
Yeah, he does, from 7 feet over the table. The wonderful pleasure of being in Beorn's house does seem to be a little bit brief. Because they do tell us, the actors have told us, we shot all this extra stuff in Mirkwood. We shot all this extra stuff at Beorn's house. And we just don't see it in the theatrical edition. Most interesting note, this is the part in the scene where Beorn, you know, talks to them the next morning and gives them, you know, cautious warnings about how much he doesn't like dwarves, but he likes orcs even less. But there was this whole bit where Beorn was going to tell us about the Battle of the Dwarves and the Orcs at Moria. And that is what we would have seen in the original two-film edit. If now it's a three.
Originally, that the story that we already know about that Balin tells us about the Battle of Azanul Bazaar. Yep. That entire story, that entire dialogue, was basically copy pasted from Beorn, and you can actually kind of hear a tone difference in the film when Beorn is talking about he put shackles on us and he used us for sport, and then like one sentence later, his voice is like just a teeny bit more higher octave, and so you can tell that they replaced the dialogue in that. So and you know, coincidentally, Beorn has 13 ponies. I mean, come on, for 13 dwarves, like that was a little weird.
He has a relationship now. That was something the movie didn't really get into, is Beorn's very Radagast type of relationship with animals, where they're all very friendly to him and he's very friendly to them, and he doesn't eat meat.
And you know, I feel like Radagast,
they only eat bread and honey at his house.
I feel like Radagast could have set them up in the first movie, like we're going toward Beorn's house, and Radagast could be like,
because
I don't really trust that guy. Like, I feel like Radagast could have been more developed in the first movie with by kind of mentioning Beorn, because they've got to be BFFs.
There's another cool thing that happens in The Hobbit: Desolation of Smaug. Another thing I really loved was the presence of a chess set. It is the second time in a Middle-earth movie that there's a direct reference to the existence of the game chess in the world of Middle-earth. In The Return of the King, Gandalf says, "The board is set. The pieces are moving." A chess reference that he says to Pippin. And now, here in Beorn's house, we see an actual real chess set with a tiny little mouse.
That was so cool.
I love Beorn holding the mouse, and you're afraid that he's going to squish it. Everyone's afraid of the fact that Beorn is ginormous and he's going to squish this mouse. But he loves animals and he's very gentle, and it's really kind of cool. And it's altogether very cool. Then the next part of the film that I thought was very well done and very clever.
Well, but before we go away from Beorn, I thought one of my biggest complaints was Azog was terrible in the first movie. He looked terrible. He just wasn't interesting. He spoke in black speech. We've never had a bad guy completely talking.
We've never had subtitled orcs before, as you know.
So I didn't like Azog. And within the first 15 minutes,
Balg shows up.
Like, he's like, "Azog, go home. I got this." So I thought that was an obvious filmmaker's trick to get Azog off the trail.
Yeah.
But I thought it was well done. But we get into the forest.
It doesn't establish the relationship between father and son very clearly, though.
No, and we don't need that.
We know that as book fans.
I don't even know if they need to be father and son now.
They are, but they don't need to be in this film. In the world of the film, they don't need to be.
I don't think Peter Jackson's made them father and son.
How about the Pippin moment that Bilbo has, where he plucks at the web? He plucks at the webs, just like Pippin, you know, pokes at the arrow, and it makes the enemy arrive sooner than they would. So that was a little Pippin Took moment. But the Mirkwood stuff, where they become delirious and lost in the illusion of the woods, was really kind of cool.
I thought it was cool how they kept repeating back and doubling back, and, like, you know, the camera tricks and everything. That was classic Peter Jackson.
Yeah.
I thought it set this woods apart from Fangorn much better. Because Fangorn was like, these trees are old. Very old.
Yeah,
you know, they're like everybody in Two Towers going to Fangorn, mm-hmm. feeling like this is an old forest and this is some stuff.
Yeah,
you know, and they go into Mirkwood, and you definitely feel here that this is a forest that's being taken over. You know,
yeah,
with all the thing. I loved the blue, you know, all the way.
Did you like the graffiti of the red eye and the graffiti of the orcs defacing the statues and the opening the entryway that had the elven designs?
Yeah, loved all that. I loved the spiders. Like, you know, I really didn't like. I got to be honest, I didn't like Shelob in Return of the King. I thought, just a set piece of a spider. But these spiders, freaking scary. I'm not scared of spiders. Like, I love spiders. But, this movie just did an awesome job, making them terrifying and you really, but it still doesn't look real, like that webbing. I didn't like the webbing that Frodo got stuck in and on. I felt that everything else in Lord of the Rings was so realistic and such careful attention. And then, so they use the same webbing here, but
they
I
did.
Think
it looks slightly different. Well, I did notice something odd. The spider poisons Frodo. I mean, Shelob. You know, Shelob's is going to poison Frodo, and somehow she manages to pierce through the mithril coat that he's wearing. When the cave troll, can't seem to pierce that mithril at all. But anyways, small caveat aside, these spiders in the Desolation of Smaug do not seem to poison Bilbo. They just wrap him up in the cobweb, and then they wrap all the other dwarves up, and they've been captured and immobilized. But, you know, it doesn't take long for Bilbo to actually get Sting out and stab that spider, and then...
And I loved, that was the best thing, taking the ring, putting it on, and hearing them talk. Yes, like, you know me, for the last 2 years, I've been like, no talking animals. There are no talking animals
That's
in Lord
exactly
of the Rings,
what you have said.
And we will not get them in The Hobbit. It's inappropriate for Peter Jackson's world that he's built. I thought that was well done. Well done, Peter, for figuring that out. We have we have additional information. Now, this is an entire collaborative process, making The Hobbit was a collaborative process going all the way back to Guillermo del Toro. On the second day of pre-production with Guillermo del Toro, Peter Jackson, Fran Walsh, and all the wed Richard Taylor, we have it on good authority that one voice raised his hand at the back of the room, Johnny Fraser Allen, who you may remember we met at Comic-Con.
I remember Johnny.
That worked,
he was great.
Yeah, he did the illustrations with Evangeline Lilly. He raised his hand in the back on the second day of pre-production with Guillermo del Toro and says, hey, wouldn't it be cool if Bilbo only heard their voices when he has the ring on? Now, so that you can attribute...
That's where that came from.
It's an entire collaborative process, and, you know,
but
other
that's
people
a good idea.
Are probably thinking, but that concept... That idea goes all the way back to Johnny Fraser Allen, a lone artist in the back, raising his hand, saying, wouldn't it be cool if, and Guillermo del Toro saying, yes, that's it. And Peter Jackson, years later, saying, you know what, that was a really good idea. We're going to keep that in. So that is one of the best examples of collaborative filmmaking. When filmmakers, you see on all the appendices and behind the scenes features that they say, you know, making films is a really collaborative process and nobody can really take credit for one thing or another. And it's true. And, you know, some Peter Jackson may have been thinking that way. Guillermo del Toro may be thinking that way. You know, other people might have been thinking, you know, this could be. But, you know, if an artist raising his hand and then they acknowledge that, that's pretty cool. So, I love the introduction in Mirkwood. I love Legolas and the elves coming in and doing their thing. I'm like, okay, this is a good... It doesn't feel forced. It doesn't feel like, we got to get to the elves and said, oh, here's elves. No, it was like, it felt really like good organic.
It felt quite smooth. But here's the trick. We, you know, in an unexpected journey, we linger for an hour in Bag End before we begin any adventure at all. In the Desolation of Smaug, we are in Thranduil's halls in 30 minutes. Exactly 30 minutes into the Desolation of Smaug, we are moving right along. We've gone from Beorn set piece to unusual experience in Mirkwood and the illusions of the forest and the weirdness of it, then spider attack, and all this action and all this incident happens in the first half an hour. So perhaps Peter was listening to the complaints of critics and fans and just speeding things up. The acceleration of events in the Desolation of Smaug makes it feel like the pacing is breathlessly paced. Even though we stop and linger for Tauriel and Keeley to have lots of conversation in their prison cell.
Thorin hadn't even showed up by now in Unexpected Journey.
That's right. In an Unexpected Journey at this point, equivalent in 30 minutes, Thorin hadn't even showed up
yet. And by this time, we've already dealt with the bear. We've already been inside the house.
Funny.
We've already gotten lost to Mirkwood. We've already dealt with spiders.
And the momentum keeps picking up from there. It just gets more and faster and faster and faster. So this is where the comparisons to the Two Towers sometimes come in. And I know you want to make a comparison, but sometimes those comparisons break down. Because, the Two Towers is not structured with the same accelerated speed and an event, the type of plot incidents Desolation of Smaug just keeps rolling and rolling and rolling and rolling. It keeps going and going and going. And there is no narrative split until the last hour of the film. Then there's a little bit of a narrative split between Lake Town and Erebor. But
we're getting a text from fans saying, "Hey, I just came onto the show now, and a second saw your outfit, Cliff. I just burst out laughing."
Good. I'm glad.
That's how I felt about watching the whole Desolation of Smaug. It was just fun. It was just fun.
Yes.
So you know, we're in Mirkwood. They're captured by the elves. It makes sense. It's like, oh, you're trespassing. We got him. Where's Bilbo? You know, and there he is again. Uh-huh. Our friend Beaufort is like, where's Bilbo? He's Beaufort's the only one that cares about Bilbo. If you watch Unexpected Journey and throughout Desolation, the only guy that's ever like, Bilbo, get back.
Balin
doesn't ever do that.
Balin reminds Thorin who his name is. Balin speaks directly in defense of Bilbo and defends him and says, Bilbo.
But not on behalf of Bilbo. On behalf of Thorin's mental health.
Beaufort
is the only one that really cares
about... Okay, Justin.
But because multiple times he's like, "Where's Bilbo?" And then when they first get to Rivendell, and they get surrounded by the elves on horses, who's the dwarf that shields Bilbo?
Beaufort. It is.
Yep. It's so Beaufort's the only one that
it's
really
not
matters.
Not Beaufort. It's Beaufort.
Whatever. But I love the fact that they put all the dwarves in things, and they brought the king of the dwarves to the king of the elves. And said, we're going to talk.
Another interesting parallel with An Unexpected Journey. Thorin is face-to-face with a goblin king, or technically the great goblin. And then in this movie, Thorin is now face-to-face as prisoner again in front of another king. And yet, a king who is no less hostile. A king who is no less hostile to him. But Thranduil doesn't plan on bringing out the torture devices. He just plans on getting his silvery jewels back. So... I think it's incredibly.
I don't know about that.
Incredibly helpful for Thorin to be shown in that Unexpected Journey added scene, that extended edition scene, where we do see the silvery necklace that Thranduil so prizes and is so interested in having.
Yeah.
So, oh my gosh, the Dyson ball vacuum is running an advertisement on our Ustream right now. Sorry about that. But
I love the dialogue of king to king. This was cool. Like,
yeah, I did think that was super cool.
And this goes back again to Two Towers and Return of the King. When we called for aid, Gondor never came. So this sets up. This is what I like about the all the kings, the goblin kings and the elven king. This is what I like about them not helping Thorin is that it sets up the age of men, the fact that men actually rally to help themselves, even though Denethor's a bad guy, and the king of Rohan, Theoden, he's like, why should we help them? Why should we help them? They didn't help us. Like, it was the same type of dialogue was happening in Lord of the Rings trilogy, where you had the realms of men were just like, we're not helping each other. And here in The Hobbit, we're not helping you. We're not help. We're no one's helping each other. And so if you look at it from the big perspective, going into Return of the King, where men actually come to rally and help each other out, then it becomes apparent, yep, the time has come for men. So we're going to sail into the West. Because they figured out, we got to help each other. So I love that Thranduil and Thorin here have a dialogue. I love the burning away of his face.
The thing with his face... makes you wonder how exactly that works. How is that supposed to work? Is the fact that Thranduil is very scarred and has been burned badly or attacked by some previous encounter with a dragon, and yet what one of the best things about the Desolation of Smaug is how Thranduil is introduced. The slow pan of the camera over his rings, his scepter, the edges of his throne, which is this great big war moose antlers over his throne, and the camera is showing all the glamour
and
of
the
his
stars
rings
in his and the, eyes. He's actually yeah, got stars
he's
in
got
his star, eyes,
like any good elf should have. But it's really interesting to me the way that we don't get slow pans across Galadriel's jewelry, and we don't see like you know, all these separate shots of her accoutrements and her her accessories. We just see Galadriel show up in her first scene in Fellowship of the Ring, walking in very stately, elegant style, the way an elf would be very stately and elegant. But it's very interesting. There's a little bit of fetish going on with the way Thranduil is talking.
He's upset. He's obsessed with the material things of this world.
Ah, yes, indeed. He is obsessed with the material things of this world in an interesting way. And maybe that's one of the reasons why the Elven King of Mirkwood is different, geopolitically speaking, than the way the other elves in Middle-earth behave. That's fascinating to me.
So I love
Hello, Tolkien-esque, and thank you for the compliment.
I love the burning up of his skin. That shows you that there is elven magic behind their long life.
And he has a magic to disguise the scar. Why wouldn't he just walk around the rest of his life with his scar visible?
Because that's elven magic. Elven magic keeps you young. Elven magic saves your life.
Keeps you young. It's not elven magic. It's just the very essence of who they are. They can be brutally killed, but they cannot just die of natural causes
Diva
or illness.
Diva Thrandy. I love it. Someone in the chat room says Diva Thrandy.
That's Diva Thrandy.
He is total diva. He's like, give me my jewels. And Thorin's like, no, bitch, no. And Thrandy's like, I got time. I can wait. And then just...
I agree. Yeah. Of all the characters in Middle-earth, at least the way they're represented in Peter Jackson's films, of all these characters, the one character who would do best on RuPaul's Drag Race absolutely would be Thranduil. Absolutely.
Okay, so let me ask you this. If Legolas...
The glamour, the way he can make himself look fabulous, and his affection for rings and jewelry, and his eyebrows. Oh, my God. Any drag queen would kill for those eyebrows.
Well done, Lee Pace.
Yeah.
Great casting.
Oh, you know what else is great about this whole scene in the movie? Just the environments that Alan Lee and John Howe created.
Oh, beautiful.
With the help of Dan Hanna and the art department.
It felt real. It didn't feel like a digital set. It felt like this is old school. Someone made this.
And there's water. The forest river is running right underneath the pathways as they walk over them. And there's shafts of light coming in from outside the caves. And it's really awesome.
Stars in his eyes, his eyebrows. Hey, I want to ask you, if Legolas Greenleaf is his son, does that make his last name Greenleaf?
No, Greenleaf is a nickname.
Well, why?
Is that not a surname?
Really? Because I thought they call him Legolas Greenleaf.
They do call him Legolas Greenleaf.
But it's kind of like Mithrandir Gandalf?
Yep. Just another name.
So he doesn't have any other names, Thranduil?
You know who has proper front and back names? The Hobbits. The Hobbits are the ones who seem to be, like, according to our world, people who have a first name and a surname. Nobody else in Middle-earth seems to do that. You know, Aragorn is Aragorn. Even though he had six or seven other proper names, he was Aragorn, but after he was crowned king, he was King Tel-Kontar. King Elisar, rather. He was King Elisar. He was King Elisar, but he was also named the Tel-Kontar, and he was named Strider, and he was named a lot of names, but he only had one name at a time.
Guy. You know, I loved the slow introduction of something between Kili and Tauriel. I loved that he's kind of tall for a dwarf. Like, you know, here's a girl that's surrounded by the hottest elves this side of Middle-earth. And you know, grass is always greener. And so here comes these...
She likes short dudes.
No, here comes something new
and
fresh. And she's like, ooh, what's this? Ooh, you're kind of cute. And he's kind of tall. You know, I thought that was well played. I don't know about the love triangle thing. I think the Laird love story would have worked without Orlando kind of
eavesdropping
or having some feelings. I feel like their love story was strong enough on its own. The surprise of their love story is the elf liking the dwarf. Okay? Back in Lord of the Rings, we had Gimli... And Galadriel is like, just give me a hair. And she gave me three. You know, like Gimli, of course, the dwarf infatuated with, and I guess that goes back to the Silmarillion, the dwarves infatuated with the elves, and they give them no time. So this is the first time that an elf has actually reciprocated some sort of...
genuine affection.
And I thought that was really well done. I thought I thought that the whole setup for getting the dwarves out of the barrels into the barrels, and just kind of Bilbo surveying the situation, watching them get drunk and everything like that.
I don't think the love triangle is a really fully manifest triangle, because
not yet.
Tauriel doesn't have. Did not extend relationship in energy to Legolas, no, and no. There's no romance with Legolas.
But Legolas is hot on her.
And we know this explicitly because Daddy says so. And Daddy says, don't go near my son. I'm not letting you date him.
Yeah. So we know Legolas has the hots for her. I feel like that
he's a Capulet. You're a Montague. Don't go near him.
So
it's like that.
But... the dwarves.
But I did like that.
Escaping in the barrels. I was always nervous about that. Like, how contrived and cartoonish that could be. But the escape and the whole scene of barrels out of Bond was amazing. From Bilbo and Martin Freeman doing Bilbo perfectly. Like, right now. Okay. All right. I am here now, by myself. So I thought the whole concept of the barrels going down the river and then blocking the river and
was a pretty cool way to do this whole set piece.
Before we
go too far down the road into the barrels out of Bond sequence, another thing I really liked about Legolas's appearance was the brief dialogue he had with Glowing, and he has the picture because they're like searching.
Who all is this?
They take
that was good.
Yeah, they take Orcrist, and he's like, this is a blade made by my kin, Thorin, why do you have this? And then he's got a picture, and he's like, who is this ugly, deformed goblin creature? And he's like, that's my son, Gimli. And Legolas raises an eyebrow. Of course, you wonder if Legolas has perfect memory. Maybe he has perfect didactic memory, and he will remember the name Gimli in the future. But Glowin has that little dialogue with
which makes me think that cool that everybody debates at the Council of Elrond in Fellowship, except Legolas, which makes me think that Legolas has a debt to pay to Gimli, and that's why he starts to befriend him. I'll bet you, by golly, Legolas has a debt to pay.
And this probably involves
the family of Gimli, son of Glóin.
I bet you that's somehow. Yeah, I bet you that's involved there.
Calling it right now.
Yeah. There might be something going on there, but Tauriel has a lot going on in this action sequence where Keeley, Tauriel, their connection happens right at the beginning of this barrels out of Bond sequence.
Their connection happens in the things, and then we don't really see much
with the spiders. It begins with the spiders.
It begins with the spiders, but there's only two really Tauriel Keeley scenes, and that's in the jail cell, and then at Bard's home. But the hero of the barrels out of Bond is 100% Robo
Bomber.
Bomber.
Robo Bomber.
That was exactly what we go to Peter Jackson films for. You know, all this whole time,
wasn't that fun?
Everybody was expecting an elf like Legolas to do the kick ass like mount the horse differently, like in Two Towers. That was amazing.
Yeah.
When he mounted the horse in Two Towers, Legolas, everyone was like
swinging from under the neck.
Did that just happen? And we got that with Bomber this time. Bomber has replaced Legolas as the hero
with the wild action sequence. I gotta fix my beard, guys. I'm gonna try to put my beard back on.
So the whole theater clapped. I've seen it 5 times, and the theater claps all 5 times when Bomber goes and then starts spinning around.
Yeah, isn't that fun?
I thought that was really cool. Now one of the things that was interesting about the barrel sequence is that we know 100%, if you look at the trailers for Desolation, that is Azog jumping up and chasing the dwarves, and so now it's Balg chasing the dwarves with the elves down the river.
There was even a shot in the trailer where Azog jumps up over the wall at the point where it's going to be in the battle.
Yeah.
And there it is.
We know it changed. Now, there was a scene right after this, or right in the middle of the barrels out of Bond, where they cut back to Gandalf.
Yeah.
And Gandalf exploring the Tomb of the Night. If you remember the DVD release back in April, March or April, we had a live stream event.
Yes, we did.
Warner Brothers never posted that production diary, I don't think. But the live stream event, we had this full sequence, special segment that Peter Jackson gave a live preview of the Tombs of the Nine. And it was longer than what was in the movie.
Yes.
And there was a lot more dialogue between Radagast and Gandalf.
Yes.
Explaining the history of the Nine, how they got imprisoned and tombed, what type of magic is holding them in their tombs. And I was waiting for that, because here's one thing that's missing from the Hobbit trilogy is the mythology. The Lord of the Rings... One of the reasons it was so successful, Lord of the Rings, is because the mythology. It started with Galadriel's retelling of the Great Battle, and throughout the whole trilogy, you're reminded about the mythology, the paths of the dead, the Fangorn Forest, the history of this and that. You're always reminded of the mythology. They dug too deep, and they unearthed the beast. And so here was an opportunity for Radagast and Gandalf to give us some of that dirty... mythology,
dirty history, drunken history of
Middle Earth. Like, tell us about the Nine. Tell us about the kings. Tell us why they were chosen. Why they were imprisoned. What type of magic could have possibly unlocked them from their graves?
But keep in mind, there were no graves in the book. In Tolkien's mind, this never happened in the book ever. So the filmmakers are pretty much on their own in inventing the reasons
why this worked. In a mountain of granite, in the deep, darkest places where nobody can get to. Mm-hmm. There's Gandalf climbing a ledge on the side of a cliff, like a Chinese stairs.
Mm-hmm.
And he felt like, okay, this is... And I just wanted to see something more. Maybe some more elvish script that says, speak friend and enter, but like, you know, where all who come here or something like that. Like, tell us a little bit more about the mythology. So that was the one scene where I'm kind of like, you know... I know there's more, and I want to see more. And I'm hoping that it's in the extended edition, because Radagast and Gandalf in those caves are what make love.
Did you
Lord
notice
Rings.
Overall that the Desolation of Smaug has the shortest running time of any Peter Jackson Middle-earth film?
Really?
The short by
I don't think so.
By 6 or 7 minutes.
Really?
Yeah, An Unexpected Journey was previously the shortest runtime. Now, Desolation of Smaug, this theatrical version, is 7 minutes shorter in duration. 7 minutes less. I can't keep the beard going. So, sorry guys, I can't keep the beard going. It just keeps falling down. But the whole dialogue... I would not have minded a few minutes more. I'm agreeing with you. For once, I'm agreeing with Justin. I would have enjoyed more of the things that Gandalf says, like, it reflects only moonlight and starlight. And when he makes little mentions about things that are historical and take us back to a deeper understanding of these characters and their own place in the world. I like that.
And so those are the two things that I felt like maybe the extended edition will flesh out.
They better.
And I hope so. The two scenes where you had the most opportunity for mythology storytelling was Beorn.
Yes.
And Radagast and Gandalf in the tombs.
But there's...
He could have cut those scenes out completely.
There's a lot more Mirkwood stuff, too. There's stuff where Bombur, who we are starting to love more and more and more, even though he has no dialogue, Bombur falls into an enchanted stream in Mirkwood and falls asleep. And everybody has to carry him unconscious through the forest. And that's one of the most...
I'm glad he cut that out.
No, it's one of the most endearing things in the book.
I already love Bombur. Yeah, like, with all the action... the two major action pieces with Bombur, I'm happy with Bombur. He didn't need
anything. But you see, most of the fans you talk to will say that they missed that. They missed the part where Bombur was asleep from falling into the enchanted stream, and the other dwarves grumble and complain because they have to carry him, and he's so heavy, and they've got to carry him through the forest.
Question, do you think Peter Jackson will have a long ending for There and Back Again like he did for Return of the King? Yes. I think he's suffering from prequelitis, and I think he thinks he can do whatever he wants. And
prequelitis.
I think it's...
There's that word again. Merry Christmas, Dwalin Dude. Have a really nice day. And Faramir number 5, I think that the ending of There and Back Again is going to be filled with a lot of surprises that will take characters off into other directions. I think we're going to see, long after the dust is settled at Erebor and the Battle of the Five Armies is over, I think we're going to see Gollum, maybe. We'll see Gollum emerging to start his search for the evil Baggins thief.
I think so.
I think we might see Viggo Mortensen show up by surprise to help Gandalf.
I told you.
Yeah,
you see where I'm going.
And I also think that we're going to see Balin and other dwarves like Owen and Ori and Dwalin. I think Balin and Dwalin and Ori and Owen are going to go and try to resettle Moria. And we might see all kinds of cool stuff. But I wonder, how much of Bilbo's journey right back to his home are we going to see?
I think...
Because Tolkien glosses over it in like one paragraph and says, Bilbo had many more adventures, but we don't have time to talk about them here.
Yeah.
And Bilbo goes right back home.
I think
he goes right back home.
Set up everything else. Now, I got to say that the major exposition, the major mythological exposition that we got was from a random orc that they captured in Mirkwood in Thranduil's kingdom, and I thought that that whole scene with Legolas and Tariel and the orc and
in
Thranduil,
the interrogation,
awesome.
Yes, it was. It
cut was. His head clean off. Said, "I gave him freedom. I set him free." I set his head free from his body, and the twitching body. Yes. That goes all the way back to Two Towers, where you see the orc's head on a stick in the pile of burning flesh, where Aragorn broke his foot.
Broke his toe. Yeah, Viggo broke his toe. Yes, he did.
Broke his toe. So I loved it, and I needed more of that.
Did you love the after the spectacular visuals of the barrels out of Bond sequence? I have to say, I'm the book fan who had lots to complain about because there were deviations from the original book. But the way Peter Jackson did that action sequence for the barrels escape is wildly deviant from the original book, and it's great. I liked it. It's fun. It's a lot of fun. It's really an example of a time when you can change from the original book and make it more cinematic and make it much more fun. The arrival in Lake Town wonderful, wonderful, wonderful stuff.
Okay, I just want to get this out of the way.
New music for Lake Town.
I loved Lake Town. I love the intro of Lake Town. I love the camera shots. I love the music. I love the design.
The ice floating in the water.
The ice, the mist. The crazy characters. I've spent many times on the shore. I've spent a lot of time on the shores of blue collar America, and that was pretty good. That was pretty accurate to the longshoreman type
yes.
City states. I thought Lake Town was awesome all around.
Yes,
and I gotta say though, throughout all the scenes in Lake Town, I heard next to me. On both sides, Larry and Cliff, the most guffaws. Like, that doesn't happen this way. So,
is that what you heard?
Allegedly, Lake Town is completely messed up from a book perspective, but from a movie perspective,
you didn't hear any guffaws
and
from me.
Characters, I thought it was well played. Every single part of Lake Town was awesome. From the master, from the storytelling, from the way they tell how the dragon's skin was pierced, and even Stephen Colbert's cameo.
Weird cameo. It's very funny.
When they're walking back, when Bard is taking the dwarves up to his house, and he's okay. Like, I'm being watched, and you have all these like random little people. Like Stephen Colbert is the guy that has an eye patch that switches it to his other side. And if you watch, Stephen Colbert is a guy sitting in a boat with a black hood, and he changes his eye patch. That's Stephen Colbert.
Oh, I'm going to take a look right again and make sure that I see that. But the funny stuff about Lake Town is that you have no idea how far astray from the original story that things are going to go. I was just absorbing the environment and the cute little pug dogs that are walking around, which happen to be Peter and Fran's dogs. Isn't that right?
Yep.
And then you've got the set design, which goes on and on and on. The set, the actual sets of Lake Town. So cool, so fascinating. And then you've got the dwarves running around and a couple of villagers
I enjoyed the potty humor.
The potty humor.
I love the dwarves hiding in the toilet.
But then again, that just makes you think, do all the humans in Lake Town just, you know, put their, like, waste directly into the water of the lake? Well, there goes your fishing. There goes your ability to catch fish on the lake if you're going to do
that.
Well,
that's why they don't fish inside the town. That's why he brings in all those fish.
Oh, I guess so.
Yeah, duh.
Well, we get some really interesting flashbacks to Geryon. Geryon, Lord of Dale. And that's when they look out the window and see a wind lance.
A wind lance. That little bow and arrow thing.
But it's like a mega crossbow that's on a giant brace. It's as big as five men. This huge thing. And it's got four corners and four angles. Like it's a double crossbow, a quadrangle crossbow, if you will. But it's called a wind lance. And then we get some interesting history. And we get to see Luke Evans. And my favorite was seeing Stephen Fry bring the Master of Lake Town to life in this great Dickensian style, like a Charles Dickens character.
I was looking forward to Stephen Fry. When I saw him in the pre-release photos before the movie came out,
yeah.
I was not. I was like, oh,
you went
good.
Down for that?
Nope. I said he looks too cartoonish, and these pictures are just like, you know, too intentional of a comb over. The pictures before I saw the movie, the pictures of the Master of Lake Town reminded me of the Lost in La Mancha, the Man of La Mancha.
Don Quixote.
I'm like, oh, come on. Like, this takes me out of a... Like, the really? Lord of the Lord of the Rings was so... They tried so hard making everything look so real. And then you get to the Master of Lake Town and the Hobbit, and everything looks so cartoony and over the top and fake. But my mind was changed in the movie. My mind was changed... Watching the film, it was
you thought that the Master of Lake Town was not cartoony and ridiculous. Do you think Alfred was a direct redux of Wormtongue?
Yes, and I think that's good.
Because you want to compare this film to Two Towers, don't you?
Yes. Alfred is definitely 100% just like Wormtongue.
There's some similarity.
But that's what you get for hiring a bunch of comedy actors cameo. And comedians.
Cameo appearance. Hello. Oh, Merry Christmas, Meltdown Comics.
So I thought
Francisco coming to help us.
You know, who played Grima Wormtongue? Brad Dourif.
Oscar winner Brad Dourif.
Oscar winner, a thespian of thespians.
Oh,
he
yes.
He is as well-respected as a dramatic performer.
Yes, he is.
As anybody in the world. And so... Lord of the Rings was stocked full of thespians, right?
Yeah, well, for sure. Yeah,
the entire cast of Lord of the Rings were thespians. Nobody was considered an actor. Even Samwise Gamgee was like the dramatic. It was Rudy. I mean,
you get to
Master of Lake Town and all the characters in Lake Town, and it's comedians, comedian after comedian after comedian after comedian. So you just have to accept that this isn't Lord of the Rings. It's The Hobbit, and so Stephen Fry got me to that point. Stephen Fry's Master of Lake Town got me to that point where we're like, you know what? It's been unfair to compare the dramatic acting
with
the comedic play that's going on here.
Thank you. Stephen Fry enriches everything that he's in. Check out V for Vendetta. He's great in everything that he's in. And check out his turn as Oscar Wilde in the movie Wild. Check out that old movie. It's really cool.
Now, so I thought Lake Town was good. I thought all the people were good. Everyone's kind of like fishy, and nobody trusts each other in Lake Town. They don't trust the mayor. They don't trust the master. They trust Bard, then they don't trust Bard, and then this guy doesn't trust that guy, and who trusts what? And nobody trusts anybody. You have to pay everybody off, which I thought was clever, especially when Gloin.
Well, these people have been economically depressed for so long.
Well, yeah. And remember when Gloin was like. I've already paid enough into this thing, and what do I have?
Yes, yes.
And then they see Erebor, the Lonely Mountain, and he's like, take all my money. We're almost there. And I got that. I thought that was really cool. So I thought.
Makes me wonder whether the dwarves had any money on them, because I thought that they were searched by the elves when they were held prisoner. And then they made a hasty escape from the elves without getting their belongings back, which is why...
They don't have any weapons.
They don't have any weapons. So, they don't have Orcrist.
That's right.
But they do have money to pay Bard, which is another continuity gaffe. Perhaps that's a problem. I don't know. But whatever.
Interesting.
Details, details, details. There's a sudden appreciation that came over me when I was in one environment, Beorn's house, and loved it. Then I was in Mirkwood, loved the environment. Then I was in Thranduil's halls, and I fell in love with the movie even more. Then when we get to Lake Town, I really, really loved, I really loved the new music and the new environments of Lake Town.
Oh, so
and
good.
I really loved what Luke Evans was doing. And then all of a sudden, things get weird.
At what point do they get weird?
When they decide to split Thorne and Company apart.
Oh, I thought that was so good.
Things get weird.
That's when things
you're like, what?
That's when Fellowship really kicked into gear. We're gonna go hunt some orc. We're gonna go take the ring to Mordor. We're captured by
we're gonna leave Bofur drunk under a table, and we're gonna leave a wounded Keeley. And then all of a sudden, a very defensive brother of Feely will come and stay with Keeley. And of course, the one of the eldest members of Thorin's traveling group would be Owen, and we know from the press notes of An Unexpected Journey that Owen is a medicine apothecary. He's a medicine practitioner. Of all the dwarves traveling in the company, he's the one who says, I will stay in Lake Town to tend to Keeley's wound. This is before we know that Evangeline Lilly's going to show up and look for Athelas.
Yeah.
Anyways, blah, 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 blah. They split Thorne and Company.
I thought that was so I thought it was a clever way of splitting the company.
Only 9 dwarves. Only 9 of the original 13 go up to find their way into Erebor. And me, I had ish. I had some ish. Just telling you. I had some ish.
As soon as that happens, like, no, dude, you stay behind, man. You're slowing us down. And it's like, I gotta stay with my brother. I thought that was cool. Like, it was a whole character building effort right there. And I thought, man, what? As soon as that happened, I was like, clever girl.
Thank you, Annie Bowman. I appreciate Annie Bowman's comment that it might have been more dwarf centric and probably a little bit cooler if Owen had used his skill as a much, much... He's hundreds of years older than Keeley. And Owen, you know, it would give John Callan, who's a wonderful actor, it would give him something really cool to do. But anyways, we end up with Tauriel showing up.
All I know is there's an extended edition scene that hopefully will be included of an epic drunken party at the Master of Lake Town's house.
The night before they leave for their big thing. Yeah, there will be a big epic party. But guess what else we have? We have another interesting side story, and this is where the single narrative of An Unexpected Journey, which was always single focused on Bilbo and Thorin and their journey, with only a brief side to go visit Radagast, and a very brief side to the White Council conversation. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, we never leave the primary point of view of Bilbo and his journey. Now we get to this part in The Desolation of Smaug where the narrative is splintered and we go and visit Dol Guldur. At the same time, Gandalf is trying to, explore Dol Guldur after he's long left the high fells of Rudaur. And Radagast has...
Radagast has been sent...
I don't understand why Radagast is personally sent to go, but I appreciated the Dol Guldur stuff. I really liked it.
That was awesome.
I loved the way that Gandalf was trying to reveal the concealment magic, and the way that Sauron is revealed in this whole thing.
Oh,
and
at first, it's good.
The necromancer who the audience who's never read Tolkien has no idea what's about to be exposed, and maybe the impact of that flaming eye wreathed in flame.
It's right there, and you felt that
maybe the audience
flaming
doesn't
eye
know
became the... organic because it was like,
and then you fall into it, and you are into the endless nothingness of Sauron as the camera flows into his eye.
That was
and there's
so
the
good.
The bipedal upright humanoid bipedal figure of Sauron is within the pupil, within the slit of the pupil.
That's new. That's new.
So cool. It was such a cool visualization. In the meantime,
everything was so good about that whole scene.
I thought it was super, super cool, but it's not true to Tolkien. I'll tell you that much. Like I talked about last week in my rant, that Tolkien, in his mythology, forbade the wizards, any of the five wizards, the Istari, they were forbidden to match power for power against Sauron. They were forbidden to do that. So it happens in the film, and it happens right in front of your face, and it's a complete, you know, departure, one of many departures. But even though I knew it was not, didn't have fidelity to the book, I thought to myself, okay, forget the fidelity for a minute, just appreciate the design of this and the way they executed the scene. Yes. I really appreciate it. I liked it anyways. Even though I knew it was not Tolkien.
Are saying that was one of the most brilliant things I've seen.
Yeah.
And yeah. Yes.
It was really brilliant. It was brilliant.
Like there have been in Unexpected Journey, there were no wow moments. There was nothing that nobody came out of Unexpected Journey saying, "I've never seen that before." Like we did with Fellowship and Two Towers. Fellowship, no one had ever seen a Balrog happen, and no one had ever seen a main character die halfway through. Like, people were like, I've never seen that before. And then Sean Bean dies at the end. And everyone came out of Fellowship going like, wow, I've never seen that before. And here we are in the middle of in Desolation, and we see the birth of the Eye, and it's like, I've never seen that before.
Yes. Well, then again, you could answer the question to Tolkien-esque, why were the Istari forbidden to match Sauron might for might? Because the gods and goddesses, or I should say the angelic powers, they were called angelic powers according to Tolkien.
Okay.
You read the Silmarillion, and you know that these powers lived in Valinor. Valinor, which is where all the elves were supposed to go, to the Undying Lands. And when they sent the five wizards to go and do their job, they thought that it would be best if the wizards inspired the hearts of all the free peoples of Middle-earth to take care of their own business, instead of the wizards just doing all the dirty work for them.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Otherwise, that would just be a shortcut to people being lazy and saying, oh, we don't have to worry about the enemy. Go let Saruman and let Gandalf deal with it.
Yeah.
They'll go do it. Yeah. So it couldn't be that way. It had to be. It's an effort to motivate characters and motivate people. And, oh, look, we actually have a call coming from merry old England. Who's calling from England, I wonder? I love having an international audience. Hello there, Emily. Are you there? Hi, how you doing? Merry Christmas to you. Can you hear us?
Yeah.
Oh, good. Well, we're trying to hear you. I'm glad you can hear us just fine.
There it is.
There it is.
The chat isn't working for me, so...
Oh, the chat's not working properly? Oh, that's weird.
All right, so
I've just got wiped instead of a chat on my computer.
Yeah, you know, it took a few minutes to load on our end too. So I think it's just that if you hit refresh and just let it load, it might go. But what did what do you think of Desolation? I mean, do you think it's a worthy successor?
I enjoyed it.
You enjoyed yourself?
I enjoyed it.
There's hesitation in your voice.
I think I enjoyed the part in Smaug better than the bit at the beginning.
Yeah.
And I was surprised that they didn't get any further.
So you're with Cliff on, like, how can they end it here?
A bit, yeah.
Don't you really think that the story would have had a nice resolution if they had dealt with the dragon and killed him by the end of the film?
I think it would have had a better resolution.
I think so, too.
Now there's going to be just... Film 3 will just be death, death, and more death.
Spoiler!
Do you know what? Tolkien wants us to learn a lesson about living through life because of our, you know, having to face death and deal with death. Did you know that in And you might know this, Emily. You probably do know this.
Well, ask her in a question.
Well, did you know that
ask her in a question.
Did you know, Emily, that Professor Tolkien meant that thematically, he intended that the entire thematic purpose of The Lord of the Rings was to deal with death? And...
Sort of.
It is to deal with death.
Well, I know he wrote the story because in the trenches, some of it.
Yeah.
Yes, he did. But the idea that some characters survive with hope, with some kind of hope intact in the face of death, is the impetus for him writing the story. Hope and the idea of living with the promise of hope in the face of death. And its many forms. That was part of the intent of him writing the whole story.
Uh-huh.
So that's why you see the chant of the Rohirrim when they come to attack in the Battle of the Pelennor Fields. You hear them chant, "Death!" You know, and you always have Gandalf facing death, and then he comes back. And then you have a lot of the characters facing the dilemma of, can we save the Shire? Can we save our lives? Or will Sauron kill everyone, and will his death and his version of death and hopelessness reign over all of life? So I think it's interesting that without the dragon being killed yet, maybe Peter Jackson is trying to delay that thematic discussion until the third film, There and Back Again, where there will be death, 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 and lots of everybody dealing with that.
Well, do you think Saruman maybe is already on Sauron's side? Because
the way he speaks to Gandalf in the first movie about when the White Council all got together.
Yeah. So do you think Smaug is on Sauron's side?
I don't think Smaug is on anybody's side. I think Smaug's just
out for himself.
Yeah.
Well, there's a brief flash of Sauron's eye within the dragon's eye, and that's when the dragon says, "You carry something that's different from gold.
Something precious
to you." And then Bilbo gets so uncomfortable with that presence of evil, he takes the ring off and shows himself to the dragon.
Mm.
That was a fascinating bit. I thought that was very interesting.
Yeah.
It seemed to suggest that Smaug is aware, at least, of stuff that's going on.
Oh, I think he's probably well aware of the presence of Sauron, and he can probably feel that something's going on around him. But I don't know if he's necessarily on his side, because, well, all he's interested in is treasure.
Yeah. Yeah, he wants his treasure, and he wants to know who these crazy people are trying to come and disturb his sleep.
All right, before we let you go, Tauriel and Keeley, yes or no?
In what concept? Do I think they should get together?
Yes.
I don't think they should necessarily get together.
Oh, see, you're really? Not a fan of the love story.
Well, I don't mind it. I don't see necessarily how a dwarf and an elf could be together.
Why you gotta be racist? Like, a man and an elf got together and everybody fell in love and was like, "Oh my god, cry."
Well, Keeley is my favorite elf and dwarf.
Yeah, see, you've even got them confused, huh?
Well, when Aragorn and Arwen get together, everyone's like, "Oh my god, shed the tears, this is such a beautiful love story." Well, why don't you think a dwarf and an elf can get together?
Well, I think men and elves are fairly similar. And there are things that say back in time that sort of men came from elves in mythology sort of terms. Like we have like things like the ancients and things. But dwarves, I see as something totally different race.
They are.
Okay.
They are indeed. Well,
all right. Well, we're gonna let you go. Thanks for calling.
Yeah, and have a very merry Christmas.
Yes.
You too. Thank you so much.
I hope you have a
great. I hope you liked my card that I sent.
Oh,
we'll look for it. Yes.
We will look for it. My gosh.
Yeah, I think I sent you it a month or so back, Cliff.
Oh dear, did you send that card? You sent that card to me, didn't you?
Yeah.
Yes, I got that. That was a lovely card. I want to say thank you.
Well, I haven't seen it because Cliff is hoarding like a dragon. So, all right, we'll talk to you later.
Emily, lovely to see you. Merry Christmas.
Bye.
Yay.
You know, she brings some good points, and I can see why her and you don't like the movie for many reasons, because you're just like, this isn't Tolkien! This isn't Tolkien! I'm like, I'm not paying for Tolkien. He's dead. I'm paying for Peter Jackson movie.
Oh my gosh.
Like, how if I want to see Tolkien, I'll go watch a cartoon. Because that's what The Hobbit was. And everyone says you're not allowed to revision Tolkien. Tolkien himself revisioned it. We've discussed this many times. How
revisioned.
He published.
Revised.
Revised. Ugh. Special editioned his own book.
He had to. Yes, he had to do a second edition.
A special edition.
Years later, he had to do a special rewrite.
He rewrote The Hobbit.
He rewrote one chapter and a couple of other small bits out of The Hobbit.
Okay, so.
But.
I thought it was clever that Bilbo figured out it was the moonlight that got into Erebor. I didn't like the fact that the dwarves just gave up, but we talked about that last episode, that they just were already like climbing down the thing. So I thought it was clever that Bilbo is the clever guy that figures out how he gets in. And
he figures out, and in the book, it's true to the book in that instance where Bilbo discovers the exterior secret stairs that take them up to the door, the side of the door. Where the trap door is.
I thought, and matching wits with the dragon, like, really? This, like, every other being in Middle Earth would have been terrified of that dragon, and Bilbo's like, your breath smells. Your breath smells. Like, I can't believe Bilbo, like, held his own on a pile of gold against a dragon who was, his tooth was bigger than Bilbo.
I'm a little bit confused about the way the Arkenstone was found, and then all of a sudden, Bilbo didn't seem to have anything to say about whether he found it or not. And then the next thing you know, the dragon is standing over them.
I'm glad that the Arkenstone has been found, but I expected like something bigger. Like he was picking up some pretty big pieces of stone and jewels, you know.
Yeah.
I thought like the Arkenstone to Bilbo's size would have been like this big, something like that. But instead, it felt like, remember Mrs. Brisby and the Rats of Nim?
Brisby,
rats, you must move your house. To the lee of the stone.
I felt like the Arkenstone was the size of Mrs. Brisby's powerful jewel at the end of it. Remember when she grabs the jewel and it's just like...
Yeah.
That's about the size of the Arkenstone. Yeah. And I thought, I was kind of expecting something bigger.
But we didn't see Bilbo pick it up. We never actually saw Bilbo pick up the Arkenstone.
No, he looked at it a lot.
He looked at it, but then something happens and Thorin's like, did you find it? Did you find the Arkenstone? And the next thing you know... All the dwarves are inside the mountain, and they're having a face-off with the dragon.
So good! And I love when the dragon goes, and you see the bellows in his stomach.
Get red, and you're
just like, oh man, this guy's about to... And, like, everything about the dragon was perfect. Good job. Thank you. Thank you, thank you for not messing that up. Thank you for giving me the dragon that we deserve. Maybe not the one that he wanted, but it's definitely the one that we all deserve.
What do you mean, maybe not the one that I wanted?
Oh, an epic dragon battle with wheelbarrows and bellows and molten gold.
And dwarf Molotov cocktails.
Yes!
Made from a dwarven chemistry set that just came out of nowhere.
Yeah. I love it. Like, they knew exactly where everything was. Like, they just left, like, yesterday.
Yeah, and it had been a very, very long time since they'd been in there. But look, all of our chemicals are still here, and our chemistry set is here, and we can make little bombs now. So they made little bombs. Do you think that they put some of those little bombs in the molten gold, or did to make?
Yeah, they did.
Yeah, I thought so.
They did. That was.
But
the whole
they
point.
Also threw some at him.
Well, yeah, just as a diversion. But yeah, it was meant for that big gold thing. You can tell the way it all came together that the whole plan was to bury. The explosives in gold, but I did like the fact that in Lord of the Rings and Fellowship, Gimli is like,
Ah, we'll get a master face. And then they see Balin and everybody's dead. And he's like, no. And then Gimli's like, I give up on life. And I'm just going to sit here and cry. Well, here we get to Thorin. When the same exact scene happens, he's like, he sees his kin. He's like, no, everybody's dead. Well, if we're going to die, I'm going to put up a fight. Forget you. So I thought that showed the kingliness of Thorin over even Gimli. You know, who gave up and was just like, well, what do we do now? Oh, they have a cave troll. Like, Gimli had given up when he saw Balin had died in Fellowship. And here we are in with the same exact thing. Well, and Thorin you know is what? Just I'm not going to go down like this.
It was a wonderful bit of animation from the digital artists at Weta. And wonderful performance by Benedict Cumberbatch. And it was really, really great to see...
Cumber-Smaug.
To see Bilbo and Smaug have to deal with each other face-to-face like that. That was really fascinating. However...
It was so desperate. Eva saying ending Smaug battle almost made me cry. It was so desperate. And I just, like, I love when they're sneaking around and they hear the ting, 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 ting. And they're like, who dropped their coins? And then they're like, oh, there's a dragon right above us. And
yeah,
and
if the dragon could have such a keen sense of smell, couldn't he have just smelled that they were right underneath him? I didn't buy that. I thought he would have smelled the fact that he was like 20 feet.
How do we know? I don't know that he can smell dwarves.
He can smell them. He can definitely smell them.
I don't know that. I didn't hear him talk about, like, you don't smell like a dwarf. He didn't talk about that.
Yes, he did, actually. He
does have. In the book, maybe, but in the movie.
In the movie, doesn't he have dialogue where he says, I recognize the smell of dwarf anywhere?
I've seen the movie five times and it's not pronounced.
Bilbo said dwarves? There's no dwarves? I don't know what you're talking about.
Well, he knows Thorin Oakenshield and everything like that is waiting outside and sending him in to be a burglar. So, like, he knows, but not. I've seen it five times, and Smaug does not make a major point about saying you don't smell like a normal thing. Because Smaug already knows Thorin is an Oakenshield. Thorin's got a whole quest. Thorin sent in a burglar. He knows about Sauron. He knows he carries a precious. Smaug knows what's up.
It seems a bit weird that Smaug is so well informed.
I know. It sounds perfect.
In the world of the book, if Smaug had been sequestered inside the mountain for all those years, he would not even have known that Thorin had earned the nickname Oakenshield. He would not even know that.
Yeah, but the Goblin King says the same thing in Unexpected Journey. He's like, call the White Orc. We've got his.
So the villains have been talking to each other. Evidently, the villains are spreading news to each other.
And then we get to Fellowship, and it's like, Sauron knows everything. He's like, hey, they got an army over here, and da-da-da. And Gandalf's like, whoa, how do you know? How does everybody know what I don't know? Like the Goblin King knew a bunch of stuff, and then Smaug knew a bunch of stuff, and then Saruman knows a bunch of stuff. That was perfect. It was perfect, perfect, perfect. Don't even need a foreshadow. It's just like the beasts and the peoples of Middle Earth are choosing sides. And the Goblin King chose evil. Smaug chose evil. Saruman chose evil. Denethor chose evil.
We're starting to see people choosing sides in this film.
That's why I think Smaug chose sides.
Well, by the time the third film is here next year, everybody's sides and their allegiance will be thoroughly staked, and then everybody will be involved in the conflict from that point forward.
How did Thorin not melt into the gold? He had a wheelbarrow, of course.
He had a magic dwarven wheelbarrow.
Wheelbarrows carry gold. Like his whole manufacturing plant was a gold plant. So, of course they're going to have wheelbarrows.
I like the idea that Smaug might have a palantir in his golden hoard. Good idea, Bofur's wife. Good idea.
Like, everybody knows. The Goblin King knows. The Smaug knows. He knows. Everybody knows about everything. Saruman knows. I bet you anything Saruman already knows. I'll bet you we don't know where all the Seeing Stones are. Remember that? He says that. We don't know where all of them are.
Yes.
I bet you they do find one here. Because Denethor has one. Saruman has one. Smaug has one. Do we know how many Seeing Stones there are?
I believe that there are seven. I believe there are seven Palantir.
We know Sauron has one.
At least.
So that's
Sauron
four.
Probably has several. There was one originally at Weathertop. There used to be a Palantir at Weathertop.
And we know Aslaug has that one because he was at Weathertop in Unexpected Journey.
Well, we don't know that Azog has that Palantir.
He was at Weathertop.
It was taken centuries before the events of The Hobbit.
Okay.
So it's long since. Saruman has one, and Denethor has one, and we perhaps could assume that Sauron has the other five.
You know what? The other five. One thing I really loved about the dragon battle was like, you know, you have a bunch of tiny little dwarves battling an epic beast of mythic proportions, and like on paper you think, there's no freaking way. An ant will not defeat me as a human. I will stamp out his anthill. Like, so you have like equivalent of scale, and you know, they really like, you see the genius of dwarves come through, and they like, they make it happen. That's what I really appreciated about the battle, was that this wasn't just like the dragon didn't just come into Erebor and like take over because he wanted a thing. Like, yeah, he's a great mythic beast, but like there was a fight to put up, because dwarves can really put up a fight, and they put up a fight. They put up an ingenious fight, and they needed to show the ingenuity of dwarves, which we haven't seen ever. We've never seen the ingenuity of dwarves. People always talk about it. The dwarves were always ingenious, and they dug too deep, and they made things that no one else could make. Mithril and things and Arkenstones and Balrogs.
Giant dwarven statues.
And yeah. Giant dwarven
statues.
They
didn't make the Balrog. They just discovered it.
Right, but they put up a battle. Like, you feel like everyone's always talked about the mythological strength and ingenuity of battle dwarves. And we finally saw that. And I watched that battle, and I'm like, now I get it. Now I know why people... Like, and now I know where dwarves are way respected when it comes to battle. Like, and this sets up for the next movie where there's like this guy named Dane or something like that. Like, now I know that dwarves are a thing to be reckoned with.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Because in Lord of the Rings, you know what a dwarf is good for? Tossing.
Okay.
That's it. That's it. Like, Gimli doesn't really serve a major purpose on any battle. In Lord of the Rings.
Except to cement a friendship with an elf.
A friend, yeah, but nothing in battle. Nothing in battle in Lord of the Rings. So this was, we needed this. We needed this epic battle with a great beast to show that freaking dwarves can handle against anything. So forget it. Forget it.
I get the part of the argument where people would say, would you rather have Thorin behave the way he does in the book, where he just sits in on the side of the mountain and cowers in fear when the dragon is roused out of his anger.
No, Thorin is not. Thorin's the kingly guy that picked up the Oakenshield.
I can appreciate this departure from the book. And, you know, I'm not all about totally adhering to the book all the time. I mean, there's a bunch of stuff that's changed from the books, which is really cool, but... I thought that the dwarven ingenuity was definitely on display, but that was such
We needed that. We needed that but before it was we go into the Battle of the Five Armies.
But it
we
was
needed
a
that.
Long and complicated set piece
so good.
With a wheelbarrow that I didn't understand. Yes. And it left me kind of scratching my head, thinking to myself,
the molten what? Things of gold that are just in there. He's like, man, let's get this fire going.
It was a good idea to see Thorin be more assertive and to be a leader and to try
We're gonna
to
die by fire.
But it was part of the problem from a cinema point of view that the dragon seemed to be less cunning and less dangerous and less smart, perhaps, because the dwarves were all of a sudden engaged in this endless cat and mouse and this cockamamie scheme that they came up with.
That
to like
sounds so stupid. Are you telling me that's what's in the book? Like, oh, there's a little dog and pony and dance, or there's a little dialogue dance? Like, I'm not going to a movie with a dragon to see him prance around with linguistics.
No, it wasn't like
what
that.
What a waste.
I'm just saying that we did need to see perhaps movie Thorin as a departure from book Thorin, in that he was more of a leader and more assertive and more...
He's going crazy.
And he's got the gold lust that's making him cray-cray. But on the other hand, the extent to which we see the dragon walking around and so easily played with and messed with by the dwarves, it did make the dragon seem a bit less dangerous. And it was to the benefit of the dwarves.
So but dangerous.
I think it made the dragon perhaps seem a little bit like...
I don't agree with you saying that he's less smart. He is more informed than anyone ever anticipated on the goings-ons in Middle Earth. He is more informed. That makes him super hyper-intelligent when it comes to knowing what the purpose and goal and what all the moving pieces of Middle Earth are. And he's forming an army here, and this guy's over here, da-da-da. Like, Smaug is informed, and he proved to be
very well-informed. Smaug was very well-informed. I thought,
that was a perfect ending. And you know what? The movie I had just come out of seeing right before I saw... Desolation was Hunger Games, and guess what? Catching Fire, same exact ending. Big epic battle, man, we're about to go here, let's get there, and then cut to black, and I'm like, oh, I want to see District 9, you know, or 13, or whatever it is.
13. District 9, different movie that we love. But okay,
Peter Jackson connected, though.
Somehow connected, but yeah. It's funny.
So there's two movies back-to-back, Hunger Games and Hobbit, where I'm just like, slam cut to black.
Misty Carey says the wheelbarrow must be made out of diamonds.
Those pots are holding the gold. Like, dwarves know what's up. You got to see the entire manufacturing apparatus and mining apparatus of dwarven intellect, and we needed to see that. There was no other way to expose that other than, it's a lot different from being a mining operation where you have a bunch of dwarves, like, sitting on things, you know, hammering at chits, versus being known as gold and mithril smiths of the Middle Earth, right?
Yes.
And so this was the only way that... So in the context of Peter Jackson's Middle Earth, it was exactly what it needed to be, and it's awesome.
Okay.
And it's 3:29. We're out of time.
We're almost out of... We are actually out of time, but you know what? Hey, Merry Christmas. Happy birthday to Tolkien-esque. Hello, happy birthday. We have some Christmas birthdays out there. To all of our fans, happy birthday to you. Thank you, Tolkien-esque, for joining us.
Yes.
And... You know what? I hope Bard is going to use a longbow.
He does use a longbow. He carries around a big longbow.
Instead of that black arrow machine. So, Ustreamer 910817, it's called a wind lance. And
the wind lance is the big thing.
The wind lance is the big thing.
He doesn't carry that around.
No, he doesn't. But in his future engagement with the dragon, when the dragon comes to attack Lake Town...
Uh-huh.
I think the wind lance will be the weapon of choice to take care of the dragon.
No, I don't think so.
You don't think so?
Because he actually says that it was hard running through the rooftops of Lake Town with a huge bow that's 10 feet long on your back.
Yeah? Well, I don't know what weapon... But at least we know there's one black arrow left. And Bard's son, Bane, has hidden it in a boat, I guess.
It'd be cool if we see Legolas do his Legolas thing and ride the dragon and then, like, pull up the dragon's hair and the dragon goes, ah! And then like, his chest is exposed and then Bard goes, poof! And then, so, yeah.
Okay, things that we're most looking forward to, of course, Billy Connolly will be joining the cast next year.
Another comedian.
There and back again. And we're going to have some dragon stuff. We're going to have a lot of dragon toys and merchandise over the next year.
I hope so. Don't fail us, Warner Brothers.
And then we're going to have the third and final film, and we have to wonder what's going to happen next. Balg has disappeared and run off into the distance. Legolas is on horseback chasing after Balg.
Azog's captured...
Azog.
Gandalf.
Azog.
Captured Gandalf.
Gandalf is held in a cage, hanging over behind, and watching the armies of Dol Guldur.
Behind an evil spell.
Saruman said in a Christmas message on YouTube that Saruman had not yet turned to evil. So we may yet see some more Saruman and Galadriel.
Oh, yeah, he definitely battle.
Yeah, so it's going to be fantastic. I think
there's
a lot of
death and destruction, and I thought... let's... To be clear, right. I think...
Thank you. I'll take
Dumbledore. I think it is a good thing.
I'll take the Dumbledore.
It's different from the Lord of the Rings trilogy. And this movie proved that you can still have a fun entertainment movie and not be the dramatic, you know, all
there
this
goes my hat.
That the Lord of the Rings was. But I think it's pretty good that nobody's died yet. No bad guys have died, and no good guys have died. Azog's still alive. Bog's still alive.
Smaug is still alive.
Smaug is still alive.
Smaug is alive.
All the dwarves are alive. All the elves are alive. Everybody's still alive.
And believe it or not, yes, Gandalf is still alive.
I'm going to let this guy close out and give his Christmas soliloquy. Thank you for appreciating.
Thank you for joining us.
And love the love story.
You do
the
not.
The music was amazing.
Listen to this when guy. Listen to this guy.
Fine. We didn't even talk about Kingsfoil, but we talked about that last time.
Aye, it's a weed. Yeah, Bard has the same dialogue that Sam has. Aye, it's a weed. But here, it's time for our closing Christmas message. Are you guys ready for this?
'Twas the night before Christmas, and all through the house,
my beard keeps falling down. I can't do this without my beard. Okay, one more time. Okay. I'm going to put my beard on. There you go.
Merry Christmas to all and to all a good night. Thank you for joining us on Torn Tuesday. And yes, Virginia, there really is a Gandalf.
See you next week. Merry Christmas, guys. Bye.